I'm going to read you a scripture out of the Living Bible. It is possible to give away and become richer. It is also possible to hold on too tightly and lose everything. Yes, the liberal man, liberal person shall be made rich. By watering others, he waters himself. I'm going to preach about mastering money. Mastering money. Do you know one of the great problems in families today is the financial problem? Homes are broken up over finances. And I want to say to you today as a local congregation, and I want to say to the television audience out there also, that God wants all of your needs supplied. The Bible says, but my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Jesus said, if you being evil know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give good things to them that ask him? Jesus said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. What are these things? What shall we eat? What shall we drink? What shall we wear? He said, if you'll just simply seek first the kingdom of God, then all these things shall be added to you. He's saying, if you serve God, he'll bless your bread, he'll bless your water, he'll take sickness out of the midst of you, and the number of your days he will fulfill. Thank God for his promises. I labor. I want to tell the television audiences, I labor to instill in this congregation the fact that God wants them out of debt with plenty of money in the bank, and they have a desire to evangelize the world. I believe your children ought to have enough to wear. I believe your family ought to have enough to eat. I believe your bills ought to be paid for. I believe God wants to bless you to where you're not always under that load. He wants you to be free of debt. Thank God this church is free of debt. For the television audience's sake, we built this church in the middle of a recession. God said, build it in the middle of the recession and pay for it in 1 year, and you'll know it's me and not you. And we paid for this church millions of dollars in 1 year. Could I have an amen? Amen. Then we have just finished our educational and office space over here, costing about $6 million. And you know what the Lord Jesus said to me to tell this congregation? You tell them you're going to build it in 1 year. You're not going to take one single offering to raise that money. Tell the people to tithe their income and to obey me when I speak to them by my spirit, to give what I tell them to give. He said, my people love me. My people obey me. You don't have to drag money out of them. And you know what happened? I told y'all, and 1 year passed, and January, we dedicated that building debt-free, $6 million. Give the Lord a hand clap. Come on, rejoice. And you know, I say to you right here, again, and I want the television audience to hear me say this. I said to the church, I said, now we have everything paid for here. Shall we be like the church of Laodicea, fold our arms and say, I'm rich and I have need of nothing? And hear Jesus say, you're poor, you're wretched, you're miserable, and you're blind. I said, no, church, let's lift up our eyes on the fields of the world, upon the cities of America, and let's take the gospel to every creature. Jesus said that we are to preach the gospel to every creature, and if he said that, then every creature is reachable. And our business is to lift up our eyes on those who have not heard of Jesus and evangelize them in every way that we can. We send out tapes. We stacked up video and audio tapes right here the other Sunday. And if you listen to all of these tapes going to about 91 nations, if you listen to them continuously for 24 hours a day, it would take you 3.5 months to listen to all of them. I'll tell you, that's a lot of word to put out in the world. You remember those projectors and those films we bought for Asia? Over 1 million people have been saved. Hallelujah. As a result of those films. And they're still going. Yes. We're almost up now to nearly 1,000 native preachers that we support in Asia. Thank God. We're reaching out into Mexico, Africa, South America, around the world. But you see, you can't do anything. You can't bless others till you get blessed. God said to Abraham, I'm going to bless you and I'm going to make you a blessing. Well, he can't make you a blessing till you get blessed. Now, I tell you, if you got nothing, you can't bless anybody with anything. So we labor to tell the people here, God is a good God. And he's not against you having enough money to pay your bills and evangelize the world. Could I have an amen?
Amen.
Now here's this parable that Jesus told. In chapter 16 it says, Jesus told this story and he said unto his disciples, there was a certain rich man which had a steward, and he the same was accused of him of wasting his goods. And he called him to him and said, how is it that I hear this of you? Give an account of your stewardship that you may no longer be a steward. Then the steward said within himself, what shall I do? My Lord's taken away from me my stewardship. I cannot dig. I'm ashamed to beg. I am resolved what to do when I am put out of the stewardship, that they may receive me into their houses. So he called every one of his Lord's debtors unto him and said, how much owest thou, my Lord? And he said, 100 measures of all. He said, sit down quickly, take your bill, and write 50. Then said he to another, how much owest thou? And he said, 100 measures of wheat. He said unto him, take thy bill, and write 80 or 80. And the Lord, his boss, commended the unjust steward because he had done wisely for the children. Now Jesus is saying this, for the children of this world are, in this generation, are wiser than the children of light. Now notice what Jesus said. And I say unto you, make to yourselves friends with a mammon of unrighteousness, which is money, that when ye fail, or they fail, they may receive you into everlasting habitations. He that is faithful in that which is least is faithful also in much. Now put your finger there and look up. It's not a matter of how much you got. It's whether you're going to be faithful with it or not. He that is faithful in least is faithful in much. He that is unjust in the least is unjust in much. If therefore you have not been faithful with money, who will commit to your trust true riches? If you have not been faithful in that which is another man's, who shall give you your own? No servant can serve two masters. He'll either love the one and hate the other, or else hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. I'm talking about mastering your money. I want this church to be the healthiest and the wealthiest and the strongest congregation in the world. I want us to do more to evangelize the world than any other local church could even think about doing. I wish every local church could do that. But we have great plans. We're not fading, we're crusading. We're not sitting looking for a rocking chair. We're looking for a mountain like Caleb. Thank God. And we want to be able to say, hear Jesus say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. But I'll tell you, if you can't pay your bills, how are you going to evangelize the world? If you're down in debt, how in the world are you going to help others? If you're not blessed, how can you pass on a blessing you don't have? So you got to get mad at the devil. You got to realize it's the devil that wants you poor, and the devil wants you in debt, and the devil wants you down, but God wants you to have plenty and to pay your debts, and he wants to lift you up. Amen. God's will is to lift you up financially. I know people are against what they call the prosperity message. I'll tell you what my message is. My message is just being against poverty. I was born in poverty, raised in poverty, and I'm telling you, poverty is not a blessing. It's a curse. But now notice here, it says this rich man. Now you know who the rich man represents? That represents God or the Lord Jesus Christ in the parable. He was rich, and for our sakes he became poor, that we through his poverty might become rich. He went back to the glories of heaven. God owns the earth. The earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. He said, the silver is mine and the gold is mine, and the cattle upon 1,000 hills. Everything in this earth belongs to God. Now, you notice this rich man has a steward. A steward is someone who watches over the affairs or the money of others. So this man had charge of this other man's money. We have charge over what God has put in our hand. Now, if you'll quit worrying about the tithe and just realize that everything you have belongs to God, you'll get on the right track. I belong to God. Everything I have belongs to God. I'm a steward of my body, my mind, my spirit, my money, everything I have. I'm a steward of God. Paul said, what do you have that you didn't receive? We all receive from God. We are stewards over the money that comes into our hands. Now this man, they found out he was wasting his God's money. And when he heard about it, he called his steward in. And he said, what's this I hear? You're crooked. You're wasting my money. You see, we are stewards of God's money. Now, if you realize God's given you everything, you belong to God, everything you make belongs to God, then you can say, now, God, what's your plan since all this is yours and I'm the steward? God says, well, I'll tell you what I want you to do. I want you to give the first dime out of every dollar into the kingdom of God in a local church someplace. Oh, just a dime out of a dollar? That's good. What do you want me to do with the rest? I'm going to give all the rest to you. Now, if I speak to you about offerings over and above that tithe, then you obey me, because it's not yours, it's mine. And just as I gave it to you, I can take it away. Notice he said, you've wasted my money. I don't want to waste God's money. So he called him in and he ended his stewardship. Give an account, he said. There will be a day when the Lord Jesus Christ, the head of the church, will call each one of us as stewards and say, give an account of your stewardship. What have you done with what I put in your hand? Well, he got real scared because he's a crook. And so he said, what shall I do? What shall I do? He said, oh my, I'm not going to have any friends. I can't dig. I'm ashamed to beg. So I better pull some kind of crooked thing here to get them to receive me in their houses. So this rich fellow came down. He said, how much you owe? He said, I owe this one. He said, right half that. This one, right less than that, right less. All of the creditors, he marked their bills down. So when he got kicked out of his job, they saw him coming. They said, hey, hi, friend. You marked down my bill half. You marked it down one third. And he said he did that so he'd have a lot of friends out there. Now, Jesus picked up on that crooked idea, and he made a tremendous point for every Christian everywhere to understand. Listen carefully to what Jesus said. He does not put his favor upon crookedness, nor cheating, or anything like that. He just said simply that the children of this generation are wiser than the children of light. He said what this scoundrel did. Now, you listen carefully, church. What this scoundrel did, he took hold of money, he mastered it, and made it work for him. He made that money get out there and prepare homes to receive him in. Are y'all listening? Master your money for good and not evil. He took charge. And he said, money, I'm going to make you make a place for me. Make me a welcome place in their houses. And Jesus said, he's wiser than the children of light. Here's what Jesus said for us to do. Now you listen to this. This is an amazing thing to fall from the lips of Jesus. He said, and I say unto you, make for yourselves friends with this unrighteous stuff we call money, so that when it fails and you fail and it's all over, the people you've helped won't receive you into their homes. They'll receive you into everlasting habitations. What does he mean? Look at your money and say, look, money, one day I'm going to leave this world. One day I'm going to stand on the high courts of heaven. One day I'm going to walk on the streets of gold. One day I'm going to breathe the pure air of heaven. One day I'm going to be in a place where there's no sighing, crying, or dying. No pain, no cancer, no arthritis, no AIDS, no kind of disease, and no death, no suffering, no pain, no sorrow. I'm so glad I'm saved, but I don't want to go there alone. I want others to go with me. God said, now you take your money and be as smart as this fella. Not by cheating, but by investing your money that they can hear the gospel. Make your money, send it to Africa, send it to Mexico, send with your money the gospel into Asia, into China, around the world. Send your money and make it preach the gospel through these little preachers all over the world, and people are going to get saved. Born again, made new creatures. They're going to get delivered out of darkness and be put in the kingdom of light. And listen, when we turn our money loose to evangelize the world, and one day when we stand in heaven in the everlasting habitation, we're going to meet little men and women all over this world, and they're going to say, it was your money that brought the gospel to me. Or, you know, we could just hoard our money and say, well, I'm not going to give to missions. I'm not going to help evangelize the world. After all, no, listen, dare to believe God. Thank God you were born in this land of gospel light. Thank God your children are not sitting in darkest India waiting for somebody to tell them how to be saved. Thank God they're not in some hut in some far off South American country down there waiting for somebody to tell them the gospel. Jesus said it's more blessed to give than to receive. We're the givers and they're the receivers. You ought to be so thankful that you are not waiting for the gospel to come to you. You ought to be thankful that you're sending the gospel to them. Yeah. Amen. And he said, look at your money. It's all mine. I can take it away in a moment's time. I can take your breath. I can take your life. All you have is from me. Learn to give me the first dime out of every dollar. That shows I'm first. Don't steal that tithe. Then obey me with the rest of it, and I'll breathe on what you got left, and it'll just multiply. If I can multiply loaves and fishes, I can multiply dollars. Amen. And God is going to give this church, and I hope you'll be included in it, more financial miracles in 1994 than we have ever had in all of our life. We've already had tremendous testimonies of miracles. God will give seed to sowers. He won't give seed to hoarders, stingy people. God will give seed to sowers. We have 7 years between now and 2000. 94, 95, 96, 97, 98, 99, 2000. 7 years of harvest. We're geared up. The nations of the world are going to hear about Jesus. They're going to get saved. They're going to get delivered. Did you know God knocked down the Iron Curtain over there and that wall, that Berlin Wall? Did you know that people in Russia and Ukraine and other places are running down church aisles to get saved? What a day we live in. What a day we live in. God has opened up the world to us. And we're not going to sit and be a lazy son or daughter in time of harvest. We're going to take every advantage of every opportunity on television, any other place, to take the gospel to the world. The Bible says, the liberal soul shall be made fat, and he that watereth shall himself be watered. So I challenge you people here, all of you. I can't make you. Nobody can make you. It's got to come from the inside of you. I challenge you to be a steward of God's money. Tithe your income and help us evangelize the world. And I challenge you out there to do the same. I'm not asking you to send us money. I'm asking you to be faithful in your local church and to do what God wants you to do there to evangelize the world. And God will bless you more. You see, we're going to get better jobs. We're going to get bonuses. We're going to get raises. We're going to own the company. We're going to have blessings financially. Because, you see, the wealth of the wicked is laid up for the just. Hallelujah. Amen. And our greatest financial days are ahead. Say, I will be faithful.
I will be faithful.
In money.
In
I'll manage it. I'll rule it. I'll master it. It will not master me. And when I get to heaven, I will find people there that will receive me into everlasting habitations because I use my money wisely. But you know, if you had all the money in the world, if you had barns full of it and a building this big full of gold and silver, you couldn't buy your salvation. You couldn't buy your way to heaven. Nobody can buy their way to heaven. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. See, salvation has already been purchased. Not by gold and silver. You were not redeemed with, destructible things and incorruptible things such as silver and gold. But by the precious blood of Jesus that was shed for you. And the greatest treasure in the world we could ever give you is not money, but salvation through the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, many of you out there are religious. You go to church, you pray, you do many things. Many of you don't. But whether you go to church or not, pray or not, many of you have an emptiness in your heart. You really don't know what it means to be born again. The greatest thing in the world is to be born again and get out of Satan's kingdom into God's kingdom. And that's what we want you to do today. Everybody's going to be very reverent here. I'm going to lead you in a prayer. Just pray this prayer. Say, oh God, I don't want to go to hell. I want to go to heaven. God, you know I'm a sinner. I know I'm a sinner. But I'm coming to you today, God, because I want to be saved. You're a good God. I heard about it today. Jesus, I believe you're the Son of God and you died for me and rose again. I want you to come into my heart, Jesus. I accept you right now as my Lord and my Savior. And I want to thank you, Jesus, that you're mine and I'm yours.
For more than 55 years, in more than 100 countries, and through books, tapes, and television, Pastor John Osteen has been preaching the simple truth, a truth that changes lives, heals the sick, and binds the broken, the truth of the saving and healing power of Jesus Christ. If you've enjoyed today's program or prayed that simple prayer with John Osteen, write us and let us know. Pastor Osteen always enjoys hearing from our television viewers. And if you'd like an audio or video copy of today's program, have your credit card ready and call 1-800-725-9191. Or send your check or money order to John Osteen, P.O. Box 23297, Houston, Texas, 77228. Every day, Lakewood Church touches the lives of people across this country and the world. Families brought together, young people delivered from drugs and violence, desperate circumstances changed, and lifelong dreams restored. We'd like to extend a personal invitation for you to visit Lakewood Church and experience the life-changing power of Jesus Christ and bring the entire family. We're especially excited about our children and youth programs that teach Bible principles in an atmosphere where learning is fun. Make a commitment this year to give church an important place in the life of your family. We'll look forward to seeing you next Sunday. Lakewood Church is located at 7400 East Houston Road and can be reached conveniently from the 610 North Loop, exiting at North Wayside Drive. Just travel north 2 more miles and turn right on Dockel Road, which ends right here at Lakewood Church. Whether it's reaching out to more than 100 countries worldwide or changing the heart of a single person, Pastor John Osteen and the congregation of Lakewood Church are touching God by touching lives. At Lakewood Church, we're here for you.